Hello, cloud gurus. Amazon Web Services has announced something very unusual this week. They are going to deprecate a service. But don't worry, because it's just EC2 Classic, and I'm sure you're already using VPCs, right? Anyway, we'll also run through lots of new things. I'm Matthias Anderson, and you're watching AWS This Week. Okay, the big news this week is that AWS is going to be getting rid of the old EC2 Classic. Now, the vast majority of you watching this are already using VPCs instead, so this won't affect you at all. I'm not even sure that a single one of you is actually still using EC2 Classic. But hey, if you are, please let us know in the comments. I'd love to read your take on this. Anyway, the only reason this is news is because AWS almost never does this. Usually, they just encourage people to move away from an old service by replacing it with something exceedingly better or cheaper, like they did with SimpleDB. And with S3's reduced redundancy storage class, for example, where they simply stopped dropping its price, and so the strictly better standard class became cheaper. But now, years later, you can still use SimpleDB and RRS, if you like paying more for less, I mean. Also, remember when Amazon announced their plan to deprecate S3 path-style URLs for new buckets in May of 2019? Well, they wound up delaying that because of the customer feedback, and it's still delayed indefinitely, with a promise to give at least one full year's notice when they do eventually proceed. Now, to be fair, Amazon has actually deprecated some features through the years, like some old versions of Lambda runtimes, for example. But Amazon's general approach is to keep things going. They have a strong reputation for backwards compatibility and price reduction. And price ties back into this EC2 Classic deprecation. Amazon stopped releasing new instance types for EC2 Classic years ago, so a migration from EC2 Classic to the newer and more efficient instance types available on VPCs is likely to save you a lot on your bill, too. Now, in case this EC2 Classic deprecation actually does affect you, you should know that nothing starts happening until the end of October, when they start by disabling EC2 Classic for any regions where your account does not have any such resources. And it's not until August 15th, 2022 that they expect all of the migrations to be complete. But as Jeff Barr writes in his blog post, "We don't plan to disrupt any workloads and we'll do our best to help you to meet these dates." Sounds like a pretty fair deal to me. Oh, speaking of AWS ending support for something, this has been a big week. On July 31st, 2022, AWS will stop fixing AWS console issues that only show up in Internet Explorer 11. Yeah, the web browser from 2013. So, feel free to upgrade to a non-ridiculous browser anytime before then, or I guess keep hobbling along because the console will probably still work for a while even after then? Your call. But okay, let's move past the support drama and let's get on to some more exciting things. Let's run through the headlines for a bunch of new goodies. AWS IoT Sitewise Edge is now generally available for processing industrial equipment data right in or close to the factory. Amazon Transcribe Call Analytics is now available to extract all sorts of analytics from contact center transcripts with a single API call. For the 11th consecutive year, AWS has been named a leader in Gartner's Magic Quadrant for Cloud Infrastructure and Platform Services, again, getting the very highest score for both ability to execute and completeness of vision. Amazon Neptune now supports both the openCypher query language and the SparkQL 1.1 Graph Store HTTP protocol. Also, Amazon Neptune ML is now generally available to streamline machine learning on your graph databases. CloudWatch gets support for trimmed mean statistics so you can exclude outliers. Also, CloudWatch now supports cross-account alarms, enabling things like centralized monitoring accounts. CloudWatch Synthetics, which runs canary scripts to do regression testing, now supports image-based checking, like pictures, I mean. You can now use custom authorization lambdas to control access to your AppSync-based GraphQL APIs. SageMaker Pipelines now supports steps to invoke Lambda functions in your ML model builds, and it can even create the lambdas for you from code. Athena Unload can now write query results in Parquet, AVRO, ORC, and JSON formats, simplifying follow-up querying and processing. And finally, EC2 Auto Scaling gets improved control for scale-in and instance refresh situations. Whew. Well, that's all the news for this week. Thanks for watching, stay safe, and keep being awesome, cloud gurus. Oh, and this being YouTube, please do that like and subscribe thing too. Thanks.